running through my veins. Today is July 8th, Friday. I'm gonna do the video today and then I'll be signing off for a few days because the 10th is my birthday. Sunday is my birthday. Sunday fun day. Sunday I'll be turning 17 again. I'm like, everyone's like, what the fuck? And I say no so nonchalantly when people are talking, they're like, how old are you? I'm like, well, I'm 17. And that blows everyone's mind and shit. So, yeah, I've always known time was bullshit, especially when I knew I wasn't going to have a childhood and I had to grow up right away and I was... I hit the streets right away. Unfortunately, I was a victim of circumstance and then I proved to not be a victim at all in the end. Everything has empowered me all the way up to here. And you're like, Simon, I thought you were talking about the Higgs ether field. I thought you were talking about the Higgs and the Higgs boson. First of all, we're not going to talk about the Higgs boson because that's the God particle. They're like, oh, yeah, that's the God particle. They're like, no, yeah. And it's funny because you guys are like atheists and shit like that. And they'll be like, oh, yeah, but there's like a God particle that, you know, that supposedly Stephen Hawking had tried to predict. Now, of course, the Higgs boson was not proven. What was proven was the Higgs field, according to mainstream science. And you guys are like, well, that's good, right? I was like, yeah, that's good for a lot of people. But it's bad for most of you that have believed in some kind of, you know, Big Bang, random, unintelligent type of reality. Now, you got to be dumb to believe that you're on... That you're existing in this plane of existence, this material plane of existence, and it's because of some dumb coincidence. You gotta be really, really dumb to believe that shit. Because that's a belief, and I've already proven that over and over. And today what we're gonna go over is the Higgs ether field. You're like, Simon, shut up and get to the point. Okay, well, let's get to the point. So the Higgs ether field, what is the Higgs ether field? We're gonna go over a couple of this. Okay. We're going to go out at what people have asked. Is the Higgs field the ether? Because you're like, wait a minute. Higgs ether field? Okay, so misconception. The Higgs field is what scientists use to call the ether. Correction. The Higgs field isn't a medium. It's a field of energy. In the late 1800s, scientists conceived of the ether as a way to explain how light spreads through space. And we're not going to go very much further just yet on the Higgs ether field. As usual, I'm going to drag this out to the point where you're going to be like, son of a bitch, Simon is just destroying everything again. Now I got to start over from scratch about what is density and mass and blah, blah, blah. Now, as the last video that I made was about the Cavendish experiment. And the Cavendish experiment, as I've proven, was debunked by Globers, like you Globeheads debunked it by trying to, you know, replicate it, but not replicating it. And the consequence to that, okay, you went out, you tried to replicate it, and what you showed was that actually it didn't work. Because if the Cavendish experiment worked, that... the apparatus, the Cavendish apparatus, would have actually pointed towards the student or towards the instructor in the classroom that's closest to it, who the instructor is definitely much more mass and weight than two bowling balls. Not only did he not replicate it and destroy it, he proven that Globers cannot replicate a science experiment in general by trying to place bowling balls on cups or whatever he was trying to place the bowling balls. That definitely that is not what Cavendish did. Cavendish explained on separate suspensions, okay, two 350 pound spheres on one suspension, and then on a smaller suspension he replaced the 1.61 pound spheres. Of course, they were both made of lead. Now, so that replication was a total failure. He did not replicate it. And what most globalists have proven is that they are naive and gullible enough to follow some type of indoctrination which twists the truth and leads them to believe something that's not even true, to the point where it debunks your whole entire ideology. As we can see, the apparatus does not point towards the instructor. It does not point towards the students in the classroom, which would be worth more mass on one side of the classroom than the other. So we have to move forward then, right? We have to sit there and say in question, okay, so this whole mass thing, it wasn't totally correct. And then here we have the Higgs ether field. Now, from my understanding, the Higgs ether field is that certain particles, you know, travel on the flat stretchy plane, the flat stretchy space-time plane, and as it does so, certain particles gain more mass than others, and it is the Higgs ether field that totally decides which particles will gain more mass than other particles. You're like, bullshit. And I'm like, that's what the mainstream science has posted. Now, before we even go further on that, since what we have right here says, what is the ether field? And it says, you know, the answer is the Higgs ether isn't a medium, it's a field of energy. In the late 1800s, scientists conceived of the ether as a way to explain how light spreads through space. Now, some of you are like, wait a minute, how is the Higgs field even tied to consciousness? And why are you even bringing all of this up without even explaining what you're talking about? We're going to move forward. We're not even going to bring up consciousness yet. We're going to go straight to light. Now, as we see the definition or the explanation that we just read right now, specifically designates as light as one of the primary factors. So we're going to go ahead and I'm going to pause the background music real quick. We're going to go ahead and watch some of these videos. Now, what we're looking at right now is plant and time lapse. As we clearly see how a plant reacts in response to light, the action and reaction, which is a Newtonian principle, we see the plant going towards light as it expands its mass. Its matter and mass is now growing towards the light. Not only is it going towards the light, it is absolutely defying gravity as we know it, and how we have been defined in indoctrination and basic education. We clearly see the plant in this time lapse, it is growing towards the light, totally contradicting what we just actually read on the definition. Okay, this is not the only plant, light, time lapse. We'll be right back. if you've been following my videos and the showings that I've been posting, I've already explained how light actually carries information. And this information goes through a process that we have labeled as photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is when a plant grabs its light, turns it into energy. Energy therefore becomes matter and mass as it expands and grows. We could clearly see the direction of the plant growing. There is no way around to debunking this in any way or form, as we can all replicate this simple experimentation with plants and light. Plants respond to light. Plants' matter and mass grow as it responds to the light in the direction it is coming. Again, this light is information. It carries information that gives the plant instructions on its matter and mass to expand and grow and multiply. There's no way around this. We can go over tons of these videos. There's tons of these videos. This is basic science. All right? So let's back up now. Let's back up to, okay, the Higgs ether field. Again, it says the Higgs field isn't a medium, it's a field of energy. In the late 1800s, scientists conceived of the ether as a way to explain how light spreads through space. There's tons of articles here. We'll go to the first one. Reach that you get researchgate.net. What is the difference between ether and Higgs field? You know what? Let's not, because these are these are personal. Although they claim to be, like, this guy claims to be Yale. Let's go ahead and read it. He claims to be from Yale University. It says, "Dear Christopher, it's not quite true to say the Higgs field does not interact with the electromagnetic field. Otherwise, the decay of the Higgs boson to two photons..." Okay, no, we got to back up. Like I said, the Higgs boson has not been proven. What was it was the Higgs field. Independent.com is not a science... Physics.Illinois. Okay. This is a .edu. This will be what you guys consider as a credible source if you're a statist and believe that the indoctrination and the doctrines you read and are told to believe are absolute truth. Let's go off what they say. And here's where I'm going to totally debunk everything. What is the difference between the Higgs field and the ether, which supposedly existed when the Michelson and Morley experiment was performed to detect the speed of light? The answer, and I quote, "The sort of ether in which people believed was a type of medium in which electromagnetic waves propagated. The speed of light would only be uniform," and there's a C, "when you measure with respect to the medium. In other frames, you'd get different speeds in different directions. The measurements showed the same speed in all directions in each frame." On a pause right there, that's the difference between Newtonian and Einsteinian gravities, is the light factor. According to Isaac Newton, if you're in a train and you're going forward in motion and you take a flashlight and you flash, a camera, and you take a picture of someone in motion, you in motion on the train see the light moving at a specific speed because you're on that enclosed system as it is totally in motion. Now, someone sitting outside the train who is total stationary would see the train moving past and see someone take that photo. Now, according to physics, the fact that someone is sitting right in front of someone else while they're in motion in an enclosed system and that flash goes off, they're closer to the flash. The person sitting far away outside the train on the bus stop, on the train stop, on a chair, supposedly observed the light at the same time. Do you guys comprehend this shit? Okay? So Isaac Newton is like, no, I seen the light, I'm sitting in the train, the person sitting outside the train didn't seen the same light at the same time, but because I was in motion, he didn't catch the same flash at the same experience in point in time. Einstein's gravity is totally different. They're like, no, they seen the same light at the same time, irregardless, because you're farther than him. Like, okay, wait a minute. So if I was a mile away and this same scenario was to play out, you're saying I would still see the same light as the person sitting in the train at the same time. If you're an Einsteinian that believes in Einsteinian gravity, you would say yes. The person farthest away, doesn't matter if you're 2 miles, 3 miles, 4 miles, it doesn't matter if you're on the other side of the imaginary globe, okay? That light was seen at the same time by both observers. That's Einstein. Newton is no. I seen the light right now, and if the light has to travel to get to the all the way down to 100 miles away for you, some other person to see the light, then so be it. That light has to travel to that person. Therefore, because of distance, we did not see the same light at the same time. That is the difference between time and space versus space-time. All right? So we'll go ahead and reread this, because I have to give you this dual view of perspective when it comes to gravity. Now, I haven't even brought up Dick gravity, and then there was Dirac. And then, and we're not even talking about the most latest form of gravity, which comes from Nusem Hussein. I believe that's his name. I'll have to look it up again. And he actually says that gravity does not exist, that it's a phenomenon. And that's actually what we'll find right now as you move forward. You'll see that that's actually the definition now, that gravity is no longer considered a force, rather it's considered a phenomenon. A phenomenon caused by space-time curvature, which I've already explained many times over, but we'll keep going this over and over as it all ties in together. Okay, so sorry, taking a sip. So this sort of ether, we're going to start all over, the sort of ether in which people believed was a type of medium in which electromagnetic waves propagated. The speed of light would only be uniform when you measured with respect to the medium. Now, we're not talking about who seen what first or who could have possibly. No, no, we're not talking about that Schrodinger's cat scenario. We're not talking about that. At this point, we're talking about how the light travels, right? Okay? In other frames, you'd get different speeds in different directions. The measurements showed the same speed in all directions in each frame. All right. The Higgs field was supposed to give rest mass to particles. If it existed, then there would be a type of propagating disturbance in it called a Higgs boson, which that's a prediction from the theory. The prediction was right. So regardless of how you use words like ether, the old theory of an electromagnetic medium was wrong because it made false predictions. The Higgs theory is looking good. Its key prediction was right. So as you guys can see, they're trying to twist it around, and basically it's the same shit. Okay? It's how light and how light travels. Now again, we're gonna move back to the video of plants. Okay, we're going to go to another one. Matter of fact, it should be on the YouTube. So we've seen how that's one video. Plant time lapse. Oh, we'll do it again. So. Oh, this is hilarious. On a side note.
There's a curvature. On Earth, okay, so that can be divided
to all the vegetarians, you guys are like, yeah, vegetarians. You can't be a carnivore.
And like,
humans are not carnivores because our teeth are not carnivorous. Like carnivores,
although,
you know, you're not like a tiger
that
or
some
a lion
could eat
or whatnot,
and
right?
Living creatures.
Okay, well,
and such a green predator has fallen into our hands.
Meet the Venus flytrap and all these
meet the
carnivorous
Venus
plants.
Flytrap. A plant
okay.
That eats
carnivorous
insects
plants don't
and
just use
spiders.
Photosynthesis.
It catches
they
its
are
victims
carnivorous.
With the help of specialized
as you can see
catching
right there,
device
what,
formed from the edges of leaves
worm is about to
that looks
ate.
Like huge and
okay.
Scary mouth
now,
with teeth.
The Venus flytrap and
inside
all the other plants, they don't have big
mouth,
teeth like
there
tigers.
Are six trigger hairs.
They don't
when
have,
the
victim they're not, they don't look like lions,
to one
okay?
Of them inside
they don't
the plant,
jump out of a tree
a
20 and
second
like,
timer
ah,
is triggered,
or a bush and then
and
like,
if the victim
and maul something to death.
The
no,
second hair during
yet they're
this
carnivorous.
Time, the jaws
so that whole
are
thing about like,
and
oh,
it's
the teeth
in
don't
a deadly
match.
Trap.
Shut the fuck up, that doesn't make sense. That's
like
not science.
This
right?
Caterpillar.
That's on a side note. So moving forward. So clearly we see how a plant responds not only to light but to water. And believe it or not, if I was to tell you that light travels through water, and that was the whole foundation of fiber optical cabling and fiber optics, fiber optical technology, was actually the fact of all people. It was Isaac Newton, and then followed by Thomas Paine, that realized that light would actually travel along water. If you have water coming from outside of a building, and the water is rolling in, and it's free, like there's nothing disturbing it, and it's coming in, it's rushing in on, say, you know, some type of irrigation or some type of little channel, the light will fall from outside, will follow the water. It'll travel along the water. And this is one of the main basic foundations. This is one of the main principles that I've said, how light and energy and information travel through water. And biological, there's two things that intelligent beings, that intelligent life forms have. And that's, they're made of water, and they're electromagnetic beings. Exactly like fiber optical cabling. All of this technology that we see about, you know, radio, and as we see right here, there's all kinds of different experiments that you can do, where you'll use, instead of light, you put a plant in darkness, and you could use radio waves to see the response and the reactions to the plant. You can also do put plants, certain plants next to your Wi-Fi router, and then other plants on the other side of the room, not next to your Wi-Fi router, to see the results. We see that electromagnetism has a direct effect on all biological life forms, irregardless of it being, you know, mammalian or plant or tree. It doesn't matter. Electromagnetism has an effect on the human, on biological life forms, because all life forms are exactly that, electromagnetic beings. And so we go back one more time. And we go back one more time to the Higgs. We'll back out one more. We'll get one more explanation. Here's another .edu. We'll see what another physicist has to say with this. So this is, what is a Higgs boson? John Hopkins physicist discussed Nobel winning find. Listen, we're not trying to find out the Higgs boson. We just want the Higgs ether field. And there's a reason for this. What is a Higgs boson? Well, what we were actually after is the Higgs field. And the Higgs boson is like a wave in this field. See, as you see right there in this first art, the first, well, that's not the first, the second section to it, that asks what is a Higgs boson, or boson, however you may want to pronounce it. You could babble it however you want to. Is that a lot of you said that the Higgs boson was a God particle, but yet here it clearly states that is like a wave in this field. The Higgs boson is not a particle at all. Okay? So another one of your fallacies or misconceptions is right there being destroyed by a physicist from JHU. Where is JHU? John Hopkins. Oh, shit. Okay. The more than a century old idea of ether appears to be wrong, but this idea, which is only half a century old, now appears to be correct. What we do in the laboratory, called the LHC, is to supply enough energy into this field, which is all around us, and create the Higgs boson out of this field. The challenge was to actually see the bosons once they were created. Now, they haven't really seen the boson. They haven't really seen the boson. And so why is it so important? All elementary particles, and here's where like gravity is totally destroyed, because gravity, as we've already established, is not a force. It's supposedly a phenomenon, and there's no particle. There's no gravity particle. There's no graviton, although it's a virtual particle that is used in mathematical equations to explain a lot of shit. But yet, it's not a real, actual, tangible particle. As a matter of fact, none of the particles are. But at least others can be detected. Now, this, the graviton cannot be detected. This is a big problem on this whole mass thing, because gravitation must have some type of mediation to it. In order for gravitation to work, mediation, and you're like, what is mediation to anyway, Simon? What is that? Okay? So mediation is like when a force moves from one place to another. There's a big problem within science. Because if you're one of these atomists that believe in atoms and everything breaks down to small pieces, and which I've already explained over and over, this whole ideology is a banker's ideology. Because what you want to do as a banker is you want to be able to chop up whatever you have and then resell it. That's business. You sell everything like that. You sell everything in bits. The more you could chop shit down and sell it, the more you could chop shit down, the easier it is to sell. That's called selling bits. Now, information technology is based on bits of information. A bit of information is a byte. Hence, we have the gigabytes, terabytes, and whatnot. Okay? So, clearly, the frequencies and bits of information all correspond and correlate to this whole concept. All right? So moving forward, we'll go ahead and read a little bit more about that, these elementary particles. So why is it so important? All elementary particles, either those from which we are made or those which help to supply energy from the sun, for example, interact with the field and acquire mass. They just said it right there, exactly what I was talking about with the plants. Obviously, the information from the sun gives plants, of course, with the backing of liquid and nutrients to gain mass and to grow and to multiply. That's information technology at its most primal foundation, as most primal principle. All right. The way they acquire mass may have cosmological consequences for our existence. Our past, present, and future depend on the properties of this field. So here we see that on that sentence alone, saying what you depend, like you, like, oh no, everything that I depend on is based on my schedule. I have a time schedule, like the UN 2030 agenda has forced everyone to comply with. There's a schedule for everything now. Time has become universal and general, where now you could impose it upon all individuals at one specific given time. Hence, you're able to now, okay, carry out large agendas, you know, large plans. Okay, sustainable development is one of these examples, prime examples. Now, as we can see, that this whole ideology depends on this, on these concepts. Without these concepts, you cannot charge people. Pun intended. Yeah, you cannot charge people for bits of information without this type of ideology. Okay, so should the field be only slightly different, we would never have come into existence. Oh, praise the field. Amen. Should the field appear unstable, we would cease to exist in an instant. Amen. The field is almighty. In fact, all indications are now that the field is metastable. Metastable, by the way, means static. Which means that it is neither stable nor unstable. So we can only guess what will happen to our universe in the future. Okay, so we're going to move back now. As we can see, we've seen the plant time. So we have action and reaction. All right, here's reaction. It involves, as well as you see, Newtonian's law of motions, classical mechanics. You're like, okay, so classical mechanics. Okay, so classical mechanics is called Newtonian. That's what I call Newtonian gravity. So when I say Newtonian gravity, I'm meaning classical mechanics. When I say Einsteinian gravity, what I'm talking about is space-time curvature, which I already explained the difference in regards to light and how it travels and how we individually perceive light, whether it being in different time and space or whether we experience it at the same time on space-time. So there's a reaction. You could always back up because, you know, action and reaction. Well, that was kind of dumb. But there's a little picture right there, action and reaction. There's a little globe head on flat water. Sorry, I had to rub that in real quick. All right, so so it comes to, we're talking about mass now. So you're like, well, okay, move forward, Simon. And we are now moving forward. So we're going to move into gases lighter than air. So we have gases like water vapor, hydrogen fluoride, acetylene, neon, and nitrogen. Helium also as well. Are theoretically, so these are lighter than air, right? So what happens is they rise. These gases rise. There's no matter to this gas. There's no matter to it. Okay? There's no mass to it. It's just a gas. But these gases rise. Then we have gases heavier than air. So now we have vapor density. Materials heavier than air, like propane, hydrogen, sulfide, ethane, butane, chlorine, sulfur dioxide. Okay, a lot of these will suffocate us and kill us. Carbon monoxide is one of these. These gases do not rise, they drop. There's no mass, there's no matter. So here we have a contradiction to the almighty indoctrination of gravity, because we have gases that contradict this whole thing. So here's where they're like, okay, well, what decides which gases are going to rise and which gases are going to drop? And we have the Higgs ether field now. Okay, the Higgs ether field is what actually comes into play, and they're able to say, okay, it's the Higgs ether field is actually deciding which particles are going to gain more mass and which are not going to gain more mass and which are not going to. So the Higgs ether field decides which particles should get more gravity or less gravity, pretty much. Now, giving all this and combining it all together, okay, we're going to move into the consciousness. And the reason why we're going to move now into consciousness is because when you start talking about mass and matter and information and the way information travels and light and water and intelligence, you have consciousness. Some people are like, no, a lot of life is not based on consciousness, and a lot of reality is based on instinct. So we'll move to instinct. Okay, so before we a lot of you are probably already trying or getting ready to try to contradict me on the videos of plant, and you're going to claim that plants are basically reacting to the action of light based on instinct. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and look at instinct now. So instinct is a noun. The definition is an innate, typically fixed pattern of behavior in animals in response to certain stimuli. Now, according to that definition, everything is instinct in regards to life. Okay? Now, when you try to question instinct, I'm sorry, where did instinct come from? So from a more biological standpoint, the brain's limbic system operates as the main control area for response to certain stimuli. Now, as we can see right there, instinct requires a brain. According to mainstream science, development evolving, the origins of the meanings of instinct. Now, if you look at it, a lot of it will try to say the instinct is tied to the brain, and that the brain is tied to evolution. But clearly, as we will move back again to plant time, the time lapse of plants clearly, absolutely, 100% contradicts this again, because of the fact that plants seem to have instinct. Do plants have brain? No. Of course they don't. Now you're going to be like, of course they don't, Simon, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Jellyfish. Here's where I slap the shit out of everyone that's going to try and say, yeah, Simon, plants don't have brains and blah, blah, blah. So although you're contradicting evolution already with the plants, now we're going to go to the other side of the spectrum and we're going to contradict it on the jellyfish side. Here we have jellyfish. Jellyfish do not have brains, yet jellyfish are one of the eldest species that are known to humankind. Jellyfish are known to be intelligent and not just instinctual, which is why they still exist. They predate humankind according to the fossil records because they predate the fossils. Okay? So this is the reason why we moved on to this video after I already had explained the evolution video on the last one. We're talking about favored races. Well, you know, there's other races that are way more favored than us humans. And that would be jellyfish, roaches, fucking ants. Lots of the majority of insects, mushrooms. Mushrooms are the third part of the animal kingdom. They're totally different. They're not animals, but they're not plants. And here we have jellyfish, which is considered, I guess, what, a sponge? Okay, so now we're going to move. So we could easily use, like, jellyfish for a lot of examples. Jellyfish are very intelligent. They're smart. They're able to complete mazes. They have proven to be, they have proven to have social skills. They have proven to actually react to stimuli that humans have placed in front of them. They actually respond to different colors. Although the jellyfish have no eyes, they know the difference between red and green and blue. These animals actually are very intelligent, which is why they've survived so fucking long. All right, no brain, no eyes, total contradiction to evolution. So, here's where we're gonna move into, like, the ether. So, and consciousness. So according to the Higgs ether field, somehow the Higgs field has chosen the jellyfish to be instinctual and intelligent, without a brain, without eyes, totally contradicting evolution and gravity. Okay, this is a marvelous example of physics and pseudoscience physics and pseudoscience, gravitational and time-space nonsense failure. This is total failure all the way around. Darwin fails here. Isaac Newton fails here. Copernicus, everyone fails here with the jellyfish. That's how much of a beautiful being this is. Now, we have to only question, is the jellyfish conscious? Because in order to be intelligent and instinctual, you have to have some type of control of yourself. You must be able to be conscious. All right. There's a lot of animals that seem to inhibit what we would define as being conscious. So moving beyond instinct, we have consciousness, the state of being awake and aware of one's surroundings. Okay. Some beings, like, say, I don't know, is it the crab or the lobster? So I believe it's a crab. So the crab basically depends on... Oh, no, the octopus. Let's move to the octopus. So the octopus depends on coral reef, rocks, and other type of environments where it could squeeze and hide from its own predators, which it really doesn't have many, but it does have some predators. Now, some octopuses have to travel across the flat plain of the ocean floor. As they do so, some of these octopuses, what they do is they'll go and they'll literally evict a crab out of a strong shell and eat them, then use that shell to cross the flat floor of the ocean floor. As it's crossing the flat floor, okay, and once it reaches a coral reef or somewhere where it's natural environment where it knows it can hide and hunt and be more comfortable and feel at ease in, it then disposes the shell like trash. Okay? All right? So somehow this octopus is able to predict its own demise, its own mortal self. If I cross that ocean floor without somewhere to hide, I will probably be attacked by one of my enemies. So what does it do? It predicts. It says, if I grab this shell and I post it on myself and use it to slowly cross the floor with it protecting me, I will survive. That is not instinct. That's intelligence and creativity. It is using something from somewhere else as a tool, exactly like a primate would, exactly like a monkey would grab a rock to crack open a coconut. All right? Now, is this jellyfish conscious? Does it have a soul? Is consciousness a soul? Okay? And as we could easily go through and we could easily go over it, of course, we're not going to actually answer this rhetorical question because this is one of the mysteries of life. What this question does, though, is it totally, absolutely contradicts the claim that evolution is absolute and the claim that there is no intelligence behind the design of reality. This is totally a contradiction to both of those concepts. Consciousness refers to your individual awareness, your unique thoughts, memories, feelings, sensations, and environments. Again, I will point out the octopus. It had an individual awareness and used its unique thoughts according to its memories and feelings and sensations and its environment to use that shell as a means to travel safely across where it has no form of defense. Okay? So moving back beyond that. We have white blood cells. Now, I explained on a few of my other videos that I've seen lots of these videos where white blood cells literally chase down other single cell life forms and amoebas and all these like different smaller life forms. And you could see, as we're about to see right now, okay, that one did not show in. That just showed some like cells getting eaten up. Like it wasn't even trying to escape.
Hi, this is Dr. O'Reilly with another plaque sample showing an unusual situation here with white blood cells in this sample. What I wanted to show you is this white blood cell in particular where you have...
Oh, I'm sorry. Is that a coronavirus?
Two nucleus inside the white blood cell instead of the usual three nucleus. And... that tells me that this white blood cell is starting to deteriorate and die. The reason why is that this cell is lined, as I'm pointing out with the arrow here, is lined with bacteria. These are actually bacteria along the cell wall or the outside membrane of this white blood cell. And this actually happens in...
So here we have bacteria clearly attacking a white blood cell. Now, bacteria are fighting back. There's literally a revolution right there going on, as we see. Bacteria are not putting up with the white blood cell. Okay? All right? The bacteria are literally fighting back right
this
there.
This is a direct sample from a patient's mouth. So this is actually happening live, where these bacteria are attaching and boring into this white blood cell to eventually kill it. So these are other manifestations of white blood cells in various shapes. This one is pretty much dead. It's got a couple of nucleuses inside. This is an old one as well. You kind of see a little bit of filaments along the edge. And this one down here, which doesn't really have any healthy nucleus inside of it. So this is what happens with your white blood cells inside your mouth when you have certain bacteria in place.
This is the one. Oh my God, we finally found it. This is the video I've been talking about. I seen this so long ago. Well, I said 6 years ago. Now look, as we watch this, I beg you all to consider, how far does consciousness go? Does it end with humans? Does it end with dogs? Does it end with cats? Does it end... Like, does it end with insects, jellyfish? Like, where is it where like you are conscious and you're not conscious, where you're actually like intelligent, like a huge, like, you know, you're intelligent or you're not intelligent, you're just dumb? Because so far, all life forms show intelligence and or instinct. Because instinct, as we've gone over the definitions and looked at everything, instinct would be also considered a form of intelligence, a lower form, a subconscious form of intelligence. Now here, we're going to watch. Now look, this is a cold-blooded video, as we see that this little bacteria, it knows it's going to die. This bacteria knows it's going to die. It is fucking running for its life. There is no escape for this poor little dude. Now, for all we know, this little dude probably could have killed a whole entire human being. You know, whatever the case may be, you can only feel sorry for this poor little dude. Because this white blood cell, he don't give a fuck. And as you can clearly see, the white blood cell, it targeted this one individual bacteria. The other bacteria is like, oh, the other bacteria just stepped out the way and got out the way and let it happen. All right, we clearly see that. We're going to back it up again. The other bacteria is panicking. We're gonna watch it one more time. Wow, it almost seems like the bacteria stopped and tried to turn around and bargain with the white blood cell. Like, it tried talking the web to, you know, it tried to communicate to the white blood cell, please stop. And the white blood cell just continued until it consumed it. We clearly see this white blood cell targeted this one bacteria above the other one. The other one seemed to even be bigger than that one bacteria. And this one bacteria ran for its life, tried to hide, tried to go around, tried to look like it was trying to bargain somehow with it until it died. Now, was that instinct? Was that intelligence? What the fuck did we just see right now? All right? Was this the Higgs ether field? Did the Higgs ether field tell this white blood cell it deserved more mass, more matter? Do you guys even science, bro?